The crestal approach with the traditional flap surgery is associated with several drawbacks, such as post-operative discomfort, unexpected gingival recession, and alveolar crestal bone resorption due to diminished supraperiosteal blood supply by flap retraction. So when the bone, the width of alveolar bone is more than 10 millimeter wide, so I'd like to recommend you to do the flapless sinus augmentation using HPISE technique.
With dental probe, approximately 3 mm gingival thickness was examined. Around carbide teeth attached with an ultrasonic piezoelectric device, surgery bone was utilized to make initial osteotomy from alveolar crest to sinus floor.
4 mm wide tissue punch was used
as close with ultrasonic piezoelectric tip. Round carbide tip is highly recommended than round diameter tip because its efficacy to cut the bone is more powerful than diameter coated tip. When surgeons use round carbide tip to approach sinus floor, please use circular motion or scraping motion for penetration of sinus floor as shown on this video. Surgeons can feel tactile sense of sinus floor penetration with their fingers easily. Thanks to micrometric cut effect and selective cut effect, membrane perforation is very low when you break sinus floor with piezoelectric round carbide tip. Surgeons can feel the tactile sensation to sinus membrane easily. A 2.8 mm wide HPISE tip with internal irrigation was positioned on the osteotomy side to apply water pressure to the sinus mucosa in order to elevate sinus membrane. The HPISE tip not only expands initial osteotomy, but also elevates sinus mucosa by utilization of water pressure. The tip should be approached to the sinus floor slowly. Please take a closer look at the water coming out from the site of first molar. This means that sinus membrane is elevated successfully before HPISE tip is not penetrated sinus floor. At this moment, sinus floor was broken by intrusion of HPISE tip into the sinus cavity. After membrane elevation at the site of second molar, the same procedure is prepared by utilization of special centrifuge, medifuge. At the altered seizure from 2400 RP 4.7 mm wide taped design implant with good initial stability. One step downsized the drill as final implant drill is critical to get initial stability of implant in the posterior as the 5 mm high. In this situation, the excised soft tissue core will be repositioned as the gingival depth measured before implant placement. A 3 mm high healing abutment was connected with implant because initial stability of implant was good as a non-submerged technique. This is post-operative panoramic view of combeam CT showing approximately 11 mm vertical augmentation of sinus. by utilization of water pressure. This is post-operative cross-sectional view of conductivity.
Resulting from this technique is as same as
resulting from laterally approached technique.
Side is
shown on this slide. This slide shows you a comparison of pre-operative and post-operative panoramic view of conductivity. This slide shows you comparison of pre-operative and post-operative cross-sectional view.
Here's another case using Flapless sinus augmentation with HPISE technique. This patient came to me from Hong Kong. Before she came to me, she visited a dental clinic in Seoul, Korea. So my colleague did bone-edit laterally approach the sinus technique with the simultaneous implant placement. Unfortunately, the sinus was impacted. And all graft material, bone graft and implants, was removed by my colleague. She was very angry at him. So, and she visited me to do the secondary sinus augmentation and implant placement from Hong Kong. You can see that the unhealed lateral wall of a sinus cavity. So the residual bone height was almost 7 millimeter or 5 millimeter respectively. So, and the ridge, the width of the alveolar ridge was favorable, so I decided to do the Flapless sinus augmentation in order to minimize post-operative discomfort. So 4 millimeter wide tooth sponge was used to expose implant sites, and round tip was used to break sinus floor directly, and HPISE tip was inserted to break sinus floor additionally and to elevate sinus mucosa at the same time. After elevating sinus mucosa, CGF membrane was flexed to accelerate bone regeneration in the sinus. Endostotomy was done, two implants were placed simultaneously. One stage procedure was done. And this is the postop radiogram. This is 5 months, 2 weeks healing. Now you can see the favorable bone regeneration around implant body. Final restoration was done. Delivered, and this is a 3 years in function. This convincity after 3 years in function, you can see the good bone regeneration around the implant body. Here's another case using a Flapless technique. The residual bone height was almost 1 to 3 millimeter on implant side. So Flapless, so 4 millimeter wide tissue punch was used to expose alveolar bone on implant site. The excised tissue core is stored in the gauze soaked with the normal saline. Gingival depth was measured before osteotomy. HPISE technique was performed to elevate the mucosa, as I mentioned before. Implant site was widened with a cylindrical pedo tip in order to accommodate 4.7 millimeter wide implant. Intermediate osteotomy was done. This slide shows elevated sinus mucosa through the osteotomy. For comparison, sticky bone was placed on second molar, but only CGF was placed on first molar. implants were placed at the same time. This slide showed you insufficient zone of attached keratinite gingiva on first molar. This is occlusal view. The excised tissue core was trimmed with a 15C blade in order to make attached keratinite gingiva around first molar. After preparing apically repositioned the flap on first molar, the trimmed tissue core was placed grafted on the lesbian side and stabilized this tissue core with the medical grade tissue cyanoacrylate. This is a sutureless FGG. This is a postop. This is a postop conveniency showing mucosal elevation in the sinus. This is 1 month. This is 3 months showing attached keratinite gingiva around first molar implant. This is final restoration. This is baseline, and this is 2 years in function. You can see good bone degeneration in the sinus. This slide shows you contraindications of HPISE technique. Lateral approach is recommended when patient has a history of sinusitis. When oral-enteral fistula exists, lateral approach is recommended because wall of pressure cannot work in the perforated sinus mucosa. Heavy cyst is seen in the sinus, lateral approach is also recommended. When sinus mucosa is perforated before mucosal elevation while doing HPISE technique, you need to do lateral approached sinus augmentation. Conclusion. Simplest is the best for a patient. The sinusitis-free sinus augmentation is patient-oriented sinus augmentation. So bone grafting should be minimized when you perform sinus augmentation in order to reduce the risk of postoperative sinusitis. Graftless sinus augmentation is highly predictable, and it is very strongly evident on newborn formation in the sinus. 0% postoperative infection is proved. So bone graft is not a prerequisite for sinus augmentation. Thank you very much for your kind attention.